Welcome to Christ the King Church, Shelby, North Carolina.
Hi, welcome to Christ the King Church. I'm Melinda, Pastor Moore's daughter. I want to welcome you to the service today, but I want to take a moment and tell you about some of our services here at Christ the King through the week. On Sunday morning, from 10 to 10:30, we have Sunday school. At 10:45, we have communion, which is open to all baptized believers. At 11 o'clock, we start our worship service. At the end of our worship service, we have a time of ministry where our elders will anoint you with oil and pray over you for healing or whatever your need may be. On Wednesdays at 7 o'clock, we have our regular midweek service. On Thursday, this is our little special meeting that I want to take a moment and explain to you about. It's called our Healing Room Evening. It's from 6:30 to 8, and it's a time of teaching and ministry time. The teaching is from 6:30 to 7:30 because we believe that faith cometh by hearing and hearing by the Word of God. At 7:30 to 8, it's the ministry portion of it, in which we have a group of people that will pray over you for whatever your need may be it physically, financially, emotionally, mentally, whatever you desire prayer for, they will come in agreement with you about. Also, if you do not have a specific need that you want prayer over, feel free to come and join us anyway from 6:30 to 7:30 during the teaching time. At this time, again, I would like to welcome you, and we will join the ministry now.
You can find a little book of Hebrews as we're getting prepared here. Hebrews chapter 1, I'm going to read a verse to you. And if you brought a Bible, I asked those of you that were in our service last evening to bring a book or a Bible with the Apocrypha in it. So we'll be doing just a little bit out of that study. Hebrews chapter 1, there's a verse that I'm going to read to you from, mine is a Revised Standard Version. This is the version we used when I did my studies at Gardner Webb, and a lot of the seminary training we used the Revised Standard Version. I have this tonight because we're going to look at a young man named Raphael, and the only place you find him is in the book of Tobit. All right, Hebrews chapter 1:14. Are they not all ministering spirits sent forth to, now my version says to serve, which is a good word because your Bible would say to minister, right? That's the word for deacon in the Greek text. So deacons were servants. So this is a good translation. Sent forth to serve for the sake of those who are to obtain salvation. Tonight my study is going to zero in on one of the archangels. There are only three that are named in the Bible. That would be Raphael, Michael, Gabriel. Those are the three archangels that are named in the Bible. To learn the name of the other four, you'll have to go outside of the scriptures and go into the book of Enoch or one of those other writings. But my whole purpose of what I've been doing on angels for the last couple services is to teach you how to hear the voice of your angel. To make you aware of his presence with you and around you all during the hours of the day. Angels, if they are revealed to you, or if you have a personal visit from one of the angels or your guardian angels, they will probably look like just a man, just a regular man. But remember, angels do not have human bodies. Now, they can transform themselves into that. They can appear in human form. That's why the Bible says at times we've entertained them unaware. We did not know we were entertaining an angel. So they must have been similar to our looks, the features that we have. They could have some of those same features. And if you study the scriptures, you'll find that they do. But they're a pure spirit beings. Not human beings. They're pure spirit beings. But like all angels, they can appear in any form. Angels are God's creation. He created angels just like he created you. Just like he created me. They're God's creation. They're created for a purpose. And that's the whole thing about God's kingdom. Everything God does, has done, or will do, it's all for a purpose. You and I are in this earth for a purpose. The angels were created for a purpose. Each angel has an assignment from God, just like you and I do. Some of those angels are assigned to, well, like our Lord. We have read that when he was in the wilderness of temptation, the Bible said the angels came and ministered to him. That's what the Bible said they are. They're ministering spirits. Some are. When Jesus was in the garden praying, he'd really prayed, probably to a point of exhaustion. And the scriptures declare that angels came and strengthened him. So you see, angels are created for a purpose. They have their assignments from God, just like you and I do. God never does anything except for a purpose. Are you okay? Now, some angels are healing angels. Raphael is a healing angel. Gabriel is a messenger angel. Michael is a warring angel. So these angels have certain functions. They're created for certain purposes. Some will minister to us to help us. Some will come and strengthen us. And of course, some will come to heal us. The word Raphael, the name Raphael, that's R-A-P-H-A-E-L. Raphael is the healer of God. He is the shining one who heals. He's also the patron saint for travelers. If you're going on a journey, it would be good to invoke his power and presence to go with you. And then thank him when you arrive at your destination safe and peaceful and refreshed. Thank him for that. He helped you get there. He is the patron saint of the traveling folks, but he's also a patron saint for the professional healers. Whatever trade your profession would be, if you're trying to bring healing to this generation, then he would be one of the angels that's involved with that. He's one of the seven archangels who stand before the throne of God. He appears by name only in the book of Tobit. And in that book, he is disguised as a human being. Everyone who travel with him or saw him in the book of Tobit, they saw him as a normal human being, and they assumed he was until he revealed himself at the end before he ascended back. So, there are angels that, of course, God has set over the healing of the earth. These are experts at bringing emotional healing, physical healing, and spiritual healing. And you remember the story in John chapter 5 where Jesus walked into an area and there was a pool there, and our Lord saw a man and he began to question him. He'd been in this condition a long time. And our Lord asked him, says, do you want to be made whole? And this man said, you know, I have no one to help put me in the pool. But see, there was a certain time, and no one knew when this was going to take place, that the Bible said an angel would descend from heaven and would stir the water. And when that water was being stirred, the first person to get into the pool, of course, was healed. Of course, Jesus healed this man without. But the traditions teach us that this is Raphael because he has healing power. Some time back, when I was meditating John 5, I heard the Lord say, he's looking for a place. You see, there was a place where these sick people were carried to. I heard the Lord say he's looking for a place. This might not be it. I don't know. But he added to that, I'm looking for a people. That's why we're doing these teachings. I need to know, are you the people that God is looking to or for to bring healing to this generation, at least to this area that we live in? He's looking for a people and he's looking for a place. I pray we could qualify. Only he knows. We've tried before to teach on the subject of angels. Now you understand, when you teach on angels, you're stepping outside of religious traditions. My wife and I ministered to a lady yesterday. An elderly lady, been in church all of her life, and she never heard one teaching on angels. I thought that was unusual. I didn't either. I never heard of angels in seminary. Never. My studies in undergraduate at Gardner-Webb University, I never heard of angels. We never had an angelology study. We never had a study on angels. No professor ever mentioned angels. That's why I'm telling you, the Bible is filled with angels. They're mentioned over 300 times in the Bible. If angels are mentioned over 300 times in the Bible, why don't we hear more about them? The angels is a great subject in the Word of God. The new birth is mentioned only one time. And there are preachers in our community that will preach on the new birth every Sunday. It's only mentioned one time. And angels are mentioned 300 times, but yet they never deal with that subject. So, the purpose of this teaching is to see if there are people who set their heart to hear, to see, a desire to know more about these spirit beings that God has created to minister to us, to serve us, to help us, to heal us. These angels are just waiting. All they need is an invitation. They just need your permission to come and minister to you. That's all they need. They will not force themselves on you. Jesse was never revealed to me until I pursued it. I said, I want to know you. I want to know your name. I want to see you. I want you to reveal yourself to me. That happened one night. Next morning, I saw him. They're just waiting on you to invite them into your life. God created them for that purpose. They've been assigned to you. They're going to help you. They'll minister to you. Can I get a witness on this? Let's talk a little bit about books, that we don't call, but some people call it the Apocrypha. The word Apocrypha is the word for hidden. They are scriptural texts that fall outside of the canon of some scriptures. They're not called Apocrypha by the Catholic Church or the Orthodox Church. The Catholic Church, the Orthodox Church, regard these books as genuine parts of the Bible. There are 7 extra books, and they're parts of 2 other books. The Protestants regard them as non-canonical. They're not a part of the canonization of the Scriptures. The reason for that, Martin Luther, when he was translating things into German, he was translating the Old Testament. He used the Hebrew Old Testament rather than the Greek Old Testament. Because of this, he took the books that they call Apocrypha, and he put them between the Old Testament and the New Testament, and he did not consider them a part of the canon of the Scriptures. He also had a dislike for the book of Hebrews. James, he called it the epistle of straw. He would like to have removed the book of James. The book of Jude and the book of Revelation, those are 4 books that Martin Luther did not like. He used the Masoretic text. He used this, and because these books were not found in that particular text, Luther considered them lower form of Scripture. Yet these books were found in older transcripts we call the Septuagint, which is the Greek for the first 5 books of the Bible. The Greek Bible had these books. The Hebrew Old Testament did not contain these. They weren't a part of Scriptures as far as the Hebrews were concerned. But the Greeks did. Jesus knew about this. He recognized this and used this. The apostles recognized and used it. The early Christians recognized these books as being inspired and a part of the Holy Scriptures. All King James publishers before 1616 included these books. One of my King James versions of the Scripture has these books in them, declaring them not really equal with Scripture. So this is where the play on things begin to come into the picture. Jews in the time of Jesus used and accepted these passages or these books as Scriptures. The apostles in the early church called them Scriptures. In 1826, the National Bible Society of Scotland petitioned the British and Foreign Bible Society not to print the Apocrypha books. And since that time, those books were omitted. 1546, the Council of Trent, which is Roman Catholic, issued its decree on the canon of the Scriptures, and they declared that all the books must be accepted as sacred and a part of the canon. So you have to form some kind of opinions. Now, when we were at Gardner Webb, the Bible we used was the Revised Standard Version, and of course it included the Apocrypha. Not necessarily did any teachings out of that, but it was in the Bible that the students used back in 1922 when I went through Gardner Webb University, which was Gardner Webb College in those days. The Eastern Orthodox Church used the Septuagint as the Old Testament version, and they considered it as being inspired, which to them was in agreement with the fathers, such as St. Augustine. So you have the divisions that have always taken place. Because of your tradition and my tradition, we probably came up in a tradition where these books were not a part of your Bible. But you have to understand the tradition we came up in is a very young tradition. Well, when I talk to you about the Catholic and the Orthodox tradition, we're going all the way back. So if Jesus considered these books scripture, if the apostles considered these books scripture, the early church considered these books scripture, why don't we consider? We're all influenced by somebody, but I'd like to be influenced by the oldest guys, the older denominations that have been around for a long, long time. And I'm going to look, first of all, there's a book called Sirach. S-I-R-A-C-H.
Say that again, please.
Sirach, S-I-R-A-C-H. This is one of the books that I'm going to look at briefly here. This book belongs to the wisdom literature. Was written by a man named Ben Sirach. It was written in the second century before Christ. It was originally written in Hebrew, but it was translated into Greek about 50 years later by his grandson. This book was included in the Greek Bible, the Greek Old Testament. This book was a part of that. Later, it began to disappear. It was rediscovered at the end of the 19th century in Cairo. Further fragments of this book have been recently found in Palestine. But the church, Orthodox, Roman Catholic, have accepted this book as a part of the canon of the Holy Bible. They've accepted it as scripture, sacred scripture. There is a passage in here that I want to read to you. It's chapter 38, and it has to do with two subjects. It has to do with physicians, and it has to do with medicine. So let me read just a little bit out of this particular 38. If you permit me, I'll just back up to 37 and read the ending of 37. This is what it says. Beginning in verse 27, "My son, test your soul while you live. See what is bad for it, and do not give it that. For not everything is good for everyone. Not every person enjoys everything. Do not have an appetite for something we call luxury. Do not give yourself up to food. For overeating brings sickness. And gluttony leads to nausea. Many have died of gluttony. But he who is careful to avoid it prolongs his life." That's pretty good wisdom, isn't it? It says the wisdom literature. It's a part of the wisdom literature. Chapter 38 says, honor the physician with the honor due him according to your need of him. My physician's aware of this and reads it.
Is this verse 1 you're doing
now? Verse 1 in chapter 38. Honor the physician with the honor due him according to the need of him, for the Lord created him. For healing comes from the Most High, and he will receive a gift from the king. The skill of the physician lifts up his head, and in the presence of great men, he is admired. The Lord created medicines from the earth, and a sensible man will not despise them. Was not water made sweet with a tree, in order that his power might be made known? He gave skill to men, that he might be glorified in his marvelous works. By them he heals and takes away pain. The pharmacist makes of them a compound. His work will never be finished. And from him health is upon the face of the earth. My son, when you are sick, do not neglect to pray. Pray the Lord, for he will heal you. Give up your faults. Direct your hands aright. Cleanse your hearts from all sin. Offer a sweet-smelling sacrifice, a memorial portion of fine flour. Pour oil on your offering as much as you can afford. And give the physician his place. For the Lord created him. This is twice he's told us this. Let him not leave you, for there's need of him. There's a time when success lies in the hands of the physicians. For they too will pray to the Lord that he should grant them success to diagnose and in healing for the sake of preserving life. He who sins before his maker may fall into the care of the physician. And then he goes on to talk here about those who mourn over the death of other people and so forth. That's the part I wanted to read to you out of the book of Sirach. I want to go back now to the book of Tobit, because this is where we encounter a guy named Raphael. I think there's 12 or 13, there's 14 chapters in this book. But there was a man who had a son. The father's name was Tobias. His son was named Tobit. And Tobias was getting some age on him. But out of this book, we learn angels and the importance of their role. We learn how to give care to the burial of dead people. And the many other things we learn out of this book. But let me just say this. Tobias, the father, is aging now. He remembers that off in the distant city, he's left money with a friend there years ago. And as he is aging, he's thinking about letting his son go to that city to get the money back. But there's a lady you're going to encounter in this book whose name is Sarah. She's been married 7 times. But every time she marries, a demon kills the husband before the marriage is ever consummated. Now, how would you like to be one of those dudes? My God, I wouldn't have been the 8th, would you?
Thank you for joining us. My prayer for you this week is that you have made Jesus Lord of your life. If not, I pray that you would have a personal visitation from him this week in which you do accept him as Lord of your life. Thank you, and we will see you next week.
Thank you for watching Christ the King Church. Follow us on Facebook, and you can also see our sermons published on YouTube.